Hey guys, welcome to another video from Channel Fireball. This time, I actually want to cover my deck list that I submitted for the MPL weekly play that is coming up in 2 days. You can start watching it on Saturday, 6 p.m. European time or 9 a.m. Pacific on Twitch TV slash Magic. It's the MPL and Rivals weekly play. And my deck of choice is Gruul aggro. I actually wanted to play Sultai. I thought my deck list was pretty good too. I spent a really long time tuning it for the mirror. But then I just eventually realized that everybody else was probably going to do the same. Sultai is the best deck in the format. But lately everybody has been dropping Fatal Pushes. They have been dropping, you know, the sweepers in favor of cards like Narset, like Tail's End, you know, Shark Typhoon, cards that are great in the mirror. But those cards are not very good against aggressive decks. And if everybody is willing to do that, just to be better in the mirror, also bringing in cards like, you know, Doom Whisper, which is one of the most effective cards in the mirror that has recently found its way into the Sultai decks because it can just one-shot Nissa. You can't interact with it with the cards like either Gust and Tail's End. So with all those changes, I was just looking at you know, other possibilities. And obviously if you play Sultai, you have to be ready to play a lot of mirror matches against literally the best players in the world, right? So that was another reason why I was maybe looking for another out. And yeah, I tried playing Sultai and I had a lot of really good results with it. I thought the deck is great. I think the metagame right now is very good for it. There's not a lot of removal, there's not a lot of sweepers, there's not that many cards like Aether Gust. And instead, as I said, people are playing all those, you know, Tails and Narset, Shark Typhoon, Doom Whisper, and stuff like that. My version is a little bit different than the normal stock list. My biggest difference is having four and Crop Crasher, which is honestly one of the best things about the deck. It is a great hit in collected company. So with four companies, you actually have basically more copies of them because you have more ways to find them. And it's amazing against Sultai. If they usually try to, you know, play one or two removal spells and then they want to stop you and stabilize with something like Anissa, Uro, Doom Whisper, just one big creature. If you can play Crasher, not only do you have one more attacker, but you also take out the one big blocker that they have and usually just either finish them off in one big swing, or you can kill the Nissa that they just played, or, you know, just swing for lethal. So Crasher right now, really, really good. If the metagame was, you know, all mono red decks with a bunch of shocks and Pillar of Flames, that'd be different because you don't want to trade your three mana for a one mana removal spell. But right now, a lot of the Sultai decks are all about, you know, five mana cards and all expensive stuff. So Crasher is really, really good against them. I'm playing them in instead of cards like Kazandu Mammoth and, you know, Rampaging Ferocidon, and all those cards are just way too slow. They don't attack right away, they don't have haste. And Ferocidon is not even that great as a way to stop life gain, because the Sultai decks usually just have a lot of removal spells anyway. So if it doesn't have haste, I don't really want to have it in my deck, especially because the three mana slot is already pretty tight. And Kazandu Mammoth, honestly, it's not a historic card. When Zendikar first came out, I was also thinking, okay, this is going to be excellent for Gruul. You know, it's going to improve my odds of hitting two creatures in collected company. I'm not going to have to play that many lands. But the reality is that you just cannot start on a comes into play tapped land. Like, this is an aggro deck. You need to curve out. You need to play one drop, two drop, three drop, then company or cleave. And you really need to have a fast draw. And Kazandu Mammoth just doesn't fit into this. So yeah, I'm pretty convinced that card just shouldn't be in a Gruul deck. You should not play it. You don't even have any fetch lands. You don't have Fabled Passages or anything to really make it bigger. So the max you can make it is 5/5, which doesn't even attack through Uro. So that doesn't really make a whole lot of sense to me right now. Something that I really like is Galia. Like, that is a way to sometimes turn excessive lands into, you know, two more cards. So it is a pretty relevant ability. And other than that, I've seen a lot of people post checklists where they cut some number of spell collectors, for example, which I don't really understand that. You definitely shouldn't do it, because the reason why this kind of deck is good is the explosive draws. It's the fact that you have Llanowar Elf and Belt Collector. Like, you're basically the only deck in the format that has eight really, really good one drops. And the fact that you have Elf, Spell Collector, and Burning Tree is the explosiveness is how you win a lot of your games. The fact that you can put so much pressure on your opponent so quickly, and they're just not able to use all the cards that they have in their hand, and they just die on turn four. So definitely don't do that. Don't cut any of the one drops. Do whatever changes you want, but these cards are untouchable. You never board them out, and you should never take them out of your deck when you're making changes. So keep the one drops in the deck. I like 22 lands. I think that's a good number. You should also make sure you play the four Ramana Prints as it's basically free. There's basically no Yasharn, which was pretty much the only downside, because Yasharn not only stops, you know, cards like all the sacrifice decks, but you also can't actually get red mana with this. So it can get awkward against that a little bit when you're trying to play instant speed Embercleave, and you know, all of a sudden you realize you only have colorless lands, which is something that happened to me. So be careful with that. But yeah, make sure to play four Ramana Prints. It just gives your deck a lot of, you know, extra reach, and I think that's great. I'm only playing two Embercleave and two Bonecrusher Giants, and the reason for that is that, you know, there's just so much Sultai right now that I was looking for. I was looking to make my deck as good as possible against Sultai, and Embercleave is, you know, pretty much a death card against them, because first of all, it's usually rotting in your hand because they're trying to, you know, get rid of your creatures, so you don't really have a lot of creatures in play, and most times they're trying to kill them with sweepers and spot removal, and playing it on a creature when you're attacking is not great either, because if they respond with a removal spell or either gust on your guy or something, then you just basically waste a turn. So Embercleave, not that great, but you still want to have it against other aggressive decks. Sideboard is just a little bit of everything. I have Cleaves against, you know, the small creature decks or tokens, or some decks that are trying to go wide, you know, decks like Goblins that are trying to chump block your creatures with, you know, maybe Goblin Matron or something. Chandra's great against decks with sweepers. I don't actually right now bring it in against Sultai because they just have creatures that are too big. You know, Doom Whisperer just one-shots Chandra, you can't kill it. So Chandra's great against something like Blue-White Control. They have a lot of sweepers, they have a lot of Baffling End, you know, all those kind of cards. They have Wrath of God, they have Shadow of the Sky, you know, all that stuff. But sometimes you just resolve Chandra, they're just looking at a bunch of Baffling Ends and they just can't do anything about it. Plus, it's another threat you can add it into play without having to worry about them going 3-for-1 against you with a sweeper. So really like that in those kind of matchups. Cloth is excellent against Sultai because it exiles their Uro and it's really, really hard for them to remove. Bonecrusher Giant comes in against other creature decks, you know, decks like Jund Sacrifice, for example, where you want to kill their priest. In the mirror against red aggressive decks, it's another way to, you know, slow them down and get a big attacker that can hold Embercleave pretty well. Scavenging Ooze, you know, also comes in for the aggressive matchups mostly, but also something against a deck like Blue-Green Paradox Engine, for example, that has, you know, a lot of ways to abuse their graveyard with Emrae and Uro and all that kind of stuff. Ebrate is similar. I bring it in for the mirror because even though sometimes it doesn't hit some of the biggest creatures, like it doesn't actually kill Questing Bees or a 4-4 Spellbreaker, it still does kill, you know, Bonecrusher, some of the smaller creatures, like an early Pelt Collector, and it's also a way to answer Embercleave. So I really like it there, you know, against the Sacrifice decks, for example. It can destroy Witch's Oven, Mayhem Devil mostly. And Magma Spray, I bring that in against the fastest decks with smaller creatures. So like Mono Red, maybe some kind of like Mono White Aggro against Auras, where you really need to kill their Core Spirit Walker and SRAM. Like you really, really need to find a hand with a removal spell. Otherwise, you pretty much cannot keep because you're just going to lose to their guy. And yeah, I think that pretty much covers everything. The mana is pretty good. Like you actually have 16 untapped green sources for turn one for your 8 green one draws, which is pretty amazing. I've played a lot of decks over the years with, you know, Elves and Birds of Paradise, but I don't think I've ever had 16 untapped green sources in a two-color deck. So there really aren't that many problems with mana, although you should pay attention to you know, your mana in all your games, and you should try to play the pathway as the last land from your hand usually. If you have Scavenging Ooze, you will want to have as many green sources as possible. On the other hand, if you have, you know, Embercleave in your hand, for example, then, you know, you already will need double red for that. And maybe you're going to draw in a haste creature off of the top. So you want to play that haste creature that's usually red. So you're going to need an extra red mana for that. You still want to have double red for Embercleave. So maybe in those kind of situations, or if you have Ramen Appearance, you are going to want to have more red sources. Other than that, I think everything is pretty self-explanatory. So let's actually play some games. All right, let's play some matches. I would like to go first. That's a pretty good hand. Do I want to start on a stomping ground? I think I actually do, because I think it's pretty likely I played this on turn two, tap, so that I don't take three while I might want to cast like a, you know, burning tree or something. I'm definitely going to attack. Looks like we are playing the mirror. And I should have actually taken a look at their land first, because if we are playing the mirror and my opponent does a Bonecrusher Giant here, then that would be really awkward. Yeah, and as I said, that's exactly what happened. Like, if I just cast my company or Questing Beast on this turn, I would be pretty far ahead. Oh well. That is fine. So here I definitely want to cast company. The question is, do I want to cast it right away? I think the answer is yes. All right, Scavenging Goose can be pretty good in the mirror. I definitely don't want to block that. But pretty much the only thing that matters in the mirror is having Embercleave. Like, whoever gets to attack first with Embercleave is pretty much the person who wins the match. I only have two green sources, so I can't attack and use Ooze. I think this is a Questing Beast turn. Let's attack. They want to trade, that's okay. My Pelt Collector is going to grow bigger. Plus I have another one, so this is a good trade for me. No, I don't think I want to block. Okay, they also have an Ooze. I like the fact that they used it right away. That's a good decision. They don't want to lose their creature to Bonecrusher Giant. So that makes sense. Two more, they have two more. I think I just do it now. Okay, second move is quite redundant. Okay, that is not an Embercleave, so what do we do now? Attack with everything? We trade those two. So I can make my Ooze into a 5/5. Yeah, let's attack. I'm gonna be able to finish their board with the Bonecrusher Giant and still have a creature in play, so that's pretty good outcome for me. Yeah, that's okay. I'll use it once to Get rid of this guy, and now... I don't think I played a land yet, have I? I played Company one of those turns, the Questing Beast, and then another Questing Beast. Yeah, I don't think I played a land yet. So I can gain an extra life. I think that is probably worth it. I can leave the creature in the graveyard for a future Scavenging Ooze, but I only have one more in the deck, and my opponent can be possibly playing up to four. But yeah, I mean, it's an extra life, so I think I should still do it, so... Let's get rid of this guy. Deal damage. Oh yeah, it also pumped my Pell Collector, so that was a pretty easy choice. I was mostly worried about having a land to play. I have enough red sources to activate this later on, just trying to figure out if I want to do this for red or for a green. Green is better for ooze, and I have enough red sources. I think green is better here. Yeah, the mirror match is kind of like whoever plays first has a huge advantage, because they're the first ones to try to start hitting. The other person has to be defensive. They have to start playing Vokra Shajans defensively and play bigger creatures with Riot instead of being on the offense, where obviously anytime you're playing first and you have Embercleave, like, you almost cannot lose. So on the draw, I like a Braid in my deck, because even though it doesn't kill some of the bigger creatures, it still gets rid of Embercleave. This is just too small. Like, 2-2 just gets outclassed immediately, so I don't actually love that in the deck against them. This is not that great on the draw. Still want to make sure I have enough creatures. 8, 12, 14, 25. 25 company hits is pretty solid. Would like to have an extra Embercleave, though. Maybe actually two extra Embercleaves. Can I board one Questing Beast, since now I have a lot of expensive cards? I think that's fine. The problem with Questing Beast is it trades against Bone Crusher and the guy with Riot against Spellbreaker, so it can be a little bit awkward on the draw. That's a fine hand, if I've ever seen one. Yeah, we have a really, really good opening hand. I can go turn two Belt Collector plus Goblin. Okay, they have a nice draw with Bone Crusher here. Now the question is, do I want to play both one drops? Do I want to play a 3-3 so my opponent stops hitting me? I can also play Lanowar Elf and a tapped land so that I save some life. It's interesting. I think I need to start growing the Pell Collector, so I'm just gonna play both of these. The question is, do I want to shock myself? I'm gonna have four mana next turn, so I can draw another. Yeah, I think I have to shock myself. I can draw another Goblin or a Braid or Bonecrusher Giant, and I would want to play both. So I think this makes sense. Sure. They got priority, so they either have a Braid or another Bonecrusher Giant here. Yeah, this is obviously better for them. Develop their board. And we have to pass. So they have something that's not Embercleave. I wonder what that is. I think I just trade these off. I'm still in a lot of trouble. Go to 11. Yeah, this is fine. Yeah, we drew a little bit too. Yeah, we should be basically just drew only lands after we kept the opening hand, so can't really do a whole lot here. Yeah, let's just play game three. That was such a good opening hand too. Any changes on the play? They also have a braids, then questing beast suddenly becomes a lot more desirable. Yeah, on the play, I don't think I even want to have that many abrades. If I even want to have any. I'll have one. On the play, you can generally be a lot more aggressive than on the draw. Because the player on the defense usually has to, you know, answer what their opponent's trying to throw at them. This one is not great. It's a lot of lands. We don't have double red source for Embercleave. Ooze without anything in the graveyard. It's not really that great. Can I keep this? I mean, Elf plus Ooze is a solid start, but after that, like, if I draw another forest, it's basically a dead draw. Interesting looking hand. I have no clue. I wouldn't fault really anybody for mulliganing this. Like, the kinds of cards you're looking for is Belt Collector, you know, some of the bigger creatures. Just Bonecrusher Giant alone is just worth more than, you know, a land and Scavenging Ooze from this hand. Because it's just such a nice 2-for-1. I think I just want to mulligan this. I don't want to take the risk. Okay, this is better. Oh, what do we throw away? One company just to be safe. I think I'm gonna take two here. Yeah, I'm gonna take two. It's more likely that I will want to have double red for Embercleave. Plus this just lets me decide later. All right, there we go. So I think I go for Crasher. That's an annoying start. No land, that is also quite annoying. All right, not much we can do. I could have played Crasher, but I think it's more likely that I just want to grow my Belt Collector. Like, if I play Company next turn, this can already be a 3-3. And at this point, I'm more about trying to stay alive than, you know, getting aggressive here. Okay, so I think I want to play Company right now because I don't want to lose my Belt Collector to a Bonecrusher Giant or something. Ooze and Bonecrusher seems quite reasonable here. And I can actually trade these off. I wouldn't mind attacking. Like, if they have Embercleave, I'm dead anyways. That's kind of how the mirror goes. Is it too aggressive to attack? I mean, I want to maximize the power of my cleave. So if I draw a land, I might just be able to kill them next turn. If I draw a land, I can play Crasher and still have two mana up for Cleave. So that'd be 10 from this. And then I have three more attackers. If we trade these off, then all of a sudden they have a much, much smaller board, which I would be a lot happier about. But then they can have just, no, maybe I'll not attack. They can like abrade this, all of a sudden I'm taking too much damage. But this is the reason why I don't like Burning Tree. Like, it just doesn't matter here. Like, the 2-2 body is just too small. The Akron War, oh my god. Okay, that's an interesting card. So I guess we're gonna have to get ready for a big attack next turn. So there's one creature in my graveyard. I think I want to attack with the Belt Collector. Yeah, I mean, I killed my own guy, but that's okay. Like, I already have a giant threat now. I'm at 15, which is pretty good, and I just want to make sure that I put as much pressure on them as possible. I'm going to take some damage now, but that's okay. Okay, so they didn't even attack. They just want to go for the big blocks. I have to attack with everything now. So I already have Cleave. I can make my Ooze into a 4-4. They don't really have great blocks. If I play Crasher and I make Brawler unable to block, how about that? Or I could just play a post-combat Ooze, which would probably be the... Or even pre-combat, because that lets me tap the Line of Werewolf without having to suicide with it. If I make this unable to block... I mean, they don't really have great blocks. Four. If I make this unable to block, they probably block with... Yeah, I think I'm actually just going to attack. And I think I want to target the Bone Crusher, actually. Because otherwise it trades with my Ooze, and I would rather not have that happen. Oh wait, I should have played the... Okay, I should not have played the Crasher. I forgot about the third ability from this. I should not have played Crasher. Because my creatures are going to die next turn. I completely forgot about that part. I should have just played a big Ooze that would have been able to pick up... Yeah, that was a complete... That was a pretty bad play. I would have been able to pick up Cleave for that Ooze next turn, just stack with that. And they wouldn't really have great block. Okay. That was not a good idea. Wait, I can still do it. Yeah, they go to two. I'll play this guy. Yeah. Wait, are they just dead on board? What is going on? Did they not block the... I can't tell what's going on from the... Okay, it's blocked by the elf. Okay, so this is block. Okay, there's only... Alright. I thought they just blocked in a way that let me kill them. Yeah, I could have had a bigger Scavenging Ooze. That was not great. That was not the best play I ever made. So it could be a 4-4 double strike. They have to block with at least two. So pretty much three. So they have to block with these three. I kill all of them. That's a pretty good trade. Then I have a Spellbreaker plus Cleave. The thing is, I can wait. If I wait a turn, I'm probably winning anyways, but they might draw something like an Abrade. And right now, if I trade this Ooze for their entire board, basically they're just going to get to keep Lanowell off, then all of a sudden that makes all their Ember Cleaves really bad. Like, basically, they can only draw company after that. So I think I'm actually going to attack. Again, they would have to block with... Yeah, they don't really have... They have to block with these three, and I'm just going to kill all of them anyway. So yeah, they don't really have great blocks. Well, that just kills all of them. So that works too. And then if we have Cleave in play, like, there's nothing to worry about. I'm just going to be able to play something, equip it later on, and kill them. The mirror is really this way. Like, whoever draws Cleave, especially on the play, just wins. Okay. Alright, that was match number one. Yeah, that wasn't really a great play against the Ekron War, not gonna lie. But that is not a card people really play in Historic, so I haven't really played against it in quite a while. Before we start Batch 2, let me remind you that all the CFB Pro members have access to special deals that are there just for the CFB Pro members. You can check it on channelfireball.com/CFB Pro Deals. They change every week. There's always something different. You can get discount or on singles, on sealed product, all kinds of special stuff every week. So make sure to check it out. And you should also sign up for CFB Pro, because you're gonna have access to all the sideboard guides and deck guides and Luis's set reviews and all the content we're working on. So make sure you check that out as well. Looks like there's a lot of mirror after today, when the decklist got revealed for the MPL weekly. All of a sudden, Gruul is pretty popular. If you're playing Sultai this weekend, yeah, another Gruul. If you're playing Sultai this weekend, make sure you have a lot of answers for Gruul, because I think it's going to be pretty popular. So I want to leave company for next turn, I think. I'm going to attack with Questing Beast now, and next turn I can try to go for a bigger attack with trying to get a Crasher, where I can just make something they have unable to block if they have like a 4/4 or something. You don't generally want to do it when they are super, super high. Yeah, we can trade these off. That's a good trade, especially when I have another Questing Beast. So yeah, that's fine. Happy to take 5 from the Mammoth. Doesn't really do a whole lot. Now I could actually company, because if I get two attackers instead of just one Questing Beast, that'd be a lot better. The problem is, do I want to risk? Like, if I just hit just one creature or even zero, even though the odds are low, that could just cost me the game. So I think it's just... Is it Questing Beast? What's the expected value of me casting company here? Let's say I get like a Haze guy and a not a Haze guy. If I get like a Pelt Collector and a 3/3 Haste, that would be at 9. I have a Pelt Collector next time I play Crasher. I probably just win. But I think I just win with Crasher anyway. So yeah, let's cast this Questing Beast. By not casting company, I think I could try to just like play around getting unlucky. Like, if I can win without it, then there's no reason for me to have to go for it. Because if I just hit, you know, one Pelt Collector or one Land Elf or something, you know, a bunch of lands, then that could be a really, really awkward turn. Interesting game. They didn't get priority for Ember Cleave, so at least they don't have that. I doubt that one to block. Because if I block and they do have Cleave, I'm super screwed. Like, at that point, I'm only attacking for 3, so I think I'm just taking this. Not a big deal. Without the cleave. Also, if they do have cleave, they still can't kill me, so don't really want to have to trade here and have a smaller border all of a sudden. The Crasher is really good against decks like Sultai or, you know, anything with just sorceries, sorcery speed sweepers or removal spells like Blue-White Control, for example. They're playing a lot of cards like Wrath of God, Shadow of the Sky, Baffling, and, you know, Teferi's trying to kill tuck your creatures at sorcery speed. Against those decks, Crasher is really, really strong. And Sultai, obviously. But obviously in, you know, the Mirror, for example, when they have a lot of cards like Burning Tree Emissary and they have a lot of tutus lying around, that's not exactly where it's at its best. Although if you're on the play, it can still win you the game sometimes. I think they have Bone Crusher. Oh no, Shadow Skull Smashing. And yeah, that's exactly seven now, so GG. So Crasher in on the draw. I want the Abrades. I want the Cleaves. I don't want some of the Crashers. I don't want Burning Trees. Gallios. So how many hits for company? 4, 10, 12. Oh yeah, I want the Oozes also. 14, 18, 19, 23 is on the lower end of where I want to be with company. Let's actually take a quick look at the odds. So population size is 60. Sample size is 23. When I hit two creatures, and six cards, we're 75%. I'm at 24, it gets up by 3%, that's not that many. I don't know if I want to have the Crasher on the draw. Like, as much as I hate Burning Tree, it just might be better. Because on the draw, like, this card really isn't all that great. I want to have Gallia. I could also just try to board in one Magma Spray, but it's only really good in the first two turns. Yeah, I'll just leave it like this. It can be a good, nice, like nice surprising hit from company, for example. Okay, that's a pretty good hand. But we're on the draw, so sometimes it just doesn't matter. Okay, no play on turn one. I like to see that. Bone Crusher, yeah, that's annoying. So this is the deck list that I think BV is playing, because I think they're the only ones with hashed out Oasis. Okay, okay. No land, okay. Yeah, I definitely want to make this a 4-4. Even though it still trades with the giant, I don't want to let this die to a braid. And like, I just wanted to have this as big as possible when I play cleave. Never mind then. And we're drawing a bunch of lands and cards we can't play. It's actually a fine draw here. Not what I was not what I was hoping for. But it does something. I think now I'm just gonna take seven, and next turn I could just pass and hold Embercleave and try to block and play it as at instant speed. But the problem is that they have cleave. Yeah, we're just dead. I'm just gonna get over with it now. They're just gonna play cleave and we're okay, maybe they just didn't want to do that. Against the Bonecrusher Giant and three more cards, like, it's extremely unlikely. We win anyways. So on the play, I don't want to have the Abrades. Maybe one is okay. And again, Burning Tree not great, Crasher not great. Definitely wasn't building my deck with the mirror in mind. Although on the play, it's probably okay. Maybe I can have two Abrades anyways. It is still pretty good too. Have an answer for cleave or just deal with the early Pelt Collector sometimes. Sure, that's a pretty decent hand. Bonecrusher Giant is so good at the mirror. Being able to kill their one drop and then play it as a 4-3 to turn after is really, really strong. This is the kind of situation where I kind of just pray for them to have a one drop. That gets killed. Now we're just waiting for cleave. Burning Tree go. Oh, that's not great for them either. Definitely don't want to trade the creatures because I'll be able to keep growing my Pelt Collector. That's fine. I think I just play Questing Beast here. Yeah, pretty easy Questing Beast. And attack with both of my creatures. They almost always have to block here, which is great for me because that's going to grow my Pelt Collector. So we're going to be able to keep pressuring them. And if I remember correctly, Paula's version only plays one collected company. So. all right then. I think we know what that means. Well, let's keep attacking then. See what they can find in company here. The worst for me would be like two more Spellbreakers, but the fact that they you hate to see it. This is nice when it happens when you play company on your own turn, but here they're not really going to be able to do much with that. They can double block and trade for Pelt Collector. Maybe if they have Braid, they can deal with Bonecrusher as well, but they're taking the damage from Questing Beast, and then I have a Crasher ready. Yeah, that didn't really go super well. This is why you should just get rid of the Burning Trees. Like, they're so small in the mirror. Okay, Crasher can take this out. Everything attacks. That is haste, so block, block. Yeah, I think they're dead. Wait. Everything attacks, but exert this attack, you can't block. Well, we won the die roll, and also our opponent had a bunch of Burning Trees in their deck. All right, match number three. I want to play against Sultai. I don't want to play mirrors. I wanted to actually, you know, show how the matches against Sultai go and why Crasher is so good in those kind of matchups. Like, if everybody all of a sudden starts playing red-green, and it's been a few hours since they revealed the deck list, but if all of a sudden everybody starts playing Gruul, like, first of all, I don't think you should be playing Gruul. You should be playing Sultai, but a different lists with more removal again. And if you are playing Gruul, maybe you don't want to have that many Crashers. that's not a hand I want to keep. Even if I had two lands, then that would still be kind of awkward. This is a lot better. I think we ditch one of the companies because we don't want to be too greedy. It's actually a pretty good hand. Turn one. Okay, so that does look like Sultai, possibly. Connor McDavid has scored his 8th career hat trick. Not bad, not bad. Not bad at all. I'll actually play Ruins. Against Sultai, I don't care about my life total too much. Oh, don't guess that. Please don't guess me, bro. Nice. So they have a removal spell, but it's not a gust. Gust would have been a lot worse for me because that would have slowed me down quite a bit. Now, the worst they can do is spiral into Languish, but most decks play, what's the name of that? The Extinction Event instead these days. Love to see Edmonton winning. It's also nice to see the NHL just to be back so we can watch some sports again. Spellbreaker go. Attack go. Sir, my opponent's draw was as good as it gets when you play against Sultai. They won the die roll, they hit a sweeper on turn 3 that got rid of two of my creatures, but they're still at 10 already because my draw was also pretty decent. Okay, this is definitely okay. So here, be careful with the lands. It's easy to just throw away the pathway or throw out the pathway, you know. Yeah, sure, I want to have double red, double green, but I want to actually have the third red source here because I will want to activate Ramina Ruins. So I think I just want to get a red source here, even though it makes me unable to cast Questing Beast if I draw one. So let's try to go for the kill here. Normally, if I played against something like blue-white control, that can have syncopate. What's going on? Oh my god. If I played against something like blue-white control, oh my god, syncopate fatal push? Wow, what a blowout. You know, with a lot of cards like Shark Typhoon, they can block my creatures and they can play a sweeper. I would just wait and play it at the end of their turn. But wow, I did not expect that. This person is a lot more ready than other people, I guess. Well, I you never expect that to actually get countered. Like, people play either Gust, sometimes they play... That's kind of it. Like, I've never actually played against Syncopate, but that can actually be good. Like, syncopating somebody's row on turn 2, on turn 3, I mean, that is kind of brutal. Syncopate could be a pretty sweet deck right now. Do we go for the Goblin? They're at 2, and then they don't know about the Crasher. We miss 1 point of damage, but we can kill them next turn through like a Nissa or something. Plus, I don't get screwed by Extinction Event as much. If I play Crasher, they go to 1. I'm just trying to see what is the worst that can happen. If they go land Uro, they're 2, they're at 8. I play Crasher and I still win. They would need to have land Fatal Push Uro, which is almost impossible. Can we still play the Crasher? I still play the Crasher, I think. I don't know what kind of cards they can have to just gain a bunch of extra life or something. I don't know. Okay, I think that That solves the problem for us. So my opponent had as good a draw as Sultai can really have. I guess they didn't really find Uro, but other than that, they put up quite a fight, and they still just lost to all the haste creatures because everything just, you know, smashes immediately. Like it makes the sweepers like not nearly as effective. That's why I preferred the haste creatures to something like, you know, the Voltaic Brawlers and just having more cards like Scavenging Ooze or, you know, more of the sorceries. More of the creatures without haste. Because it feels a lot worse when they play a sweeper against you. If you didn't really get anything out of your guys. Whereas with haste, you can at least attack and, you know, sure, you played a sweeper, but at least my guy already dealt 3 damage, so that's something. So again, Sultai Cleave is bad. They're going to have a lot of removal. They're going to be trying to kill my creatures. I think Bokush is also bad. They didn't really have any targets. And you can also board out Galia because it is unlikely you're going to have 3 creatures attacking at the same time. Ooze is great because it's a proactive answer to Uro. Sometimes I bring it in, sometimes I don't. If they have a lot of removal, I like to have Chandra. Because, you know, they're usually just sitting on Fatal Pushes and all these sweepers and Eliminates and Heartless Acts and whatnot. And you can just, you know, easily get them with a Planeswalker. But be careful to not have too many expensive cards. So I like to board out Embercleave for that reason too. Because I already have 9 4 mana cards right now. But yeah, this is pretty clean sideboarding. Cloth is obviously amazing against them. I still have 10 2 drops. So my curve is still pretty nice. So that seems reasonable. It's a pretty good hand. You also have a lot of value after sideboard, like having the extra damage from your lands is nice in the late game. Like Collected Company is some extra value. Like Chandra can sometimes just get them. Let's just play one elf. Sure, that's fine. Have a replacement. Yeah, my draw is really, really nice here. That syncopate though in game one did get me pretty well. I would love them to fatal push my guy again. Yeah, this is interesting. Do I go for Yeah, I don't want to go for Burning Tree Crasher because that is really, really bad against Languish. What I want to do here is Burning Tree Chandra or pass and play Collected Company at the end of their turn. Do not let them use their mana effectively, but I think I want to go for Chandra. Oh wow, okay. So they don't really have anything. Well, that's good. Yeah, now I'm not too worried about sweepers. If you want to play a language here to kill 2 of my guys, that's okay. Next turn, I can see what I get from Chandra. Then I can either pressure them some more. Oh wow, Pulse is really good here. Pulse is nice. That changes things quite a bit. Now the question is, do I want to get possibly blown out by a sweeper here? But the more time you give them, the more likely it is that they play something like Anissa, and all of a sudden you have to attack through a bunch of lands. Interesting. I'm really afraid of a sweeper. So if I play this, probably get like 4 damage right away out of it.
Whatever. Let's go for it. Haste. Haste. Like, I have some reach with the Ramina Prince. I do have the Crasher as well. I don't know if that was a... that was a play. Okay. We tried. We tried. I should have played the Ruins and not this. Yeah, they would have maybe even been forced to play the Languish anyways in those two guys. Yeah, this is exactly the part where knowing your opponent deck list is super valuable. Yeah, like right now I see that they have so many sweepers. Okay, that's a pretty nice draw. Definitely haste it out. Is it more likely they will be able to discard this from my hand or destroy it in play? So against Blue White Control, for example, they have cards like Field of Ruin. So holding it would be better here. It's nice that they're not going to know that I'm going to be able to kill them next turn with the Colossus. Something nice you can do, by the way, that sometimes comes up that people don't do too often. If your Colossus gets either gusted, you could play Collected Company if you already have it in your next upkeep, so that you get the at the beginning of your pre-combat main phase trigger still on the same turn, which is sometimes really, really important because it can immediately exile their Uro, for example. So keep that in mind. Sometimes you can do that as a really, really, really cool play that sometimes matters. All right. Finally played against Sultai. We did get a little lucky with the Collected Company towards the end. But any kind of haste creature, you know, would have been pretty good at that point. Yeah, that was pretty much it. I don't know if there's anything else I really wanted to mention. Yeah, keep in mind that these... yeah, you can tell that I tested quite a bit of Sultai. Sultai post-sideboard, pre-sideboard, mirror sideboard versus Gruul. Where's the MP? Okay, here. Yeah, keep in mind that we chose these lists for the MPL tournament where you only have 24 players, so we only had a very specific metagame in mind. Like, we were trying to metagame a little bit. We were expecting a lot of Sultai. That metagame can definitely change right now. And who knows? You know, it's still 2 days until the qualifier, so maybe some big streamers start, you know, playing Gruul in the next couple of days. Maybe a lot of other people are going to play Gruul in the qualifier, and you know, you want to maybe try to tune your deck a little bit more for the mirror instead of just, you know, being as good against Sultai as possible. If you are trying to tune it for the mirror, then I would definitely try to fit in an extra Cleave and an extra Bonecrusher Giant. The only really cuttable cards at that point are probably either the Galias or the Goblins. Maybe, actually, you would probably have to cut one Questing Beast. If you want to play a third Cleave, I think you have to cut one Questing Beast because you just cannot afford to play too many expensive cards. But yeah, that's kind of about it. I like this deck, the way it's built, quite a bit against the current Sultai lists. So if you're trying to beat that mostly, this is fine. But yeah, if you're going to play the mirrors, then be ready to either, you know, board in a bunch of these cards or possibly put the third Cleave into the deck, because that's one of the most important cards in the mirror, if not the most important. So yeah, thanks a lot for watching, and I will see you guys next time.